We normally assume that the velocity vector should point in the direction of applied force. Then why does the centripetal force in circular motion cause objects to have velocity vectors perpendicular to it? Let us look at this ball moving in a straight line. If you apply a force perpendicular to its line of motion, the ball will start moving like this. Apply the same force again, perpendicular to the new path, the ball changes its direction again. And if we keep applying the same force in smaller time gaps, the ball will start moving in a path that starts looking like circular motion. And if the time interval becomes infinitesimally small, this ball starts undergoing uniform circular motion due to this centripetal force. So what we learned is that if an object is continuously acted upon by a force that is perpendicular to its velocity, the object will start moving in a circle, and this force that causes circular motion is called the centripetal force. Now, let us say you are driving in a car that is moving at a constant speed along a straight road, and then you take a sudden left turn in a circular arc and you find yourself sliding across the seat towards the right and then getting jammed against the car door for the rest of the turn. So what really is happening here? Let us try to understand this in small bites. When the car moves in the circular arc, it is in uniform circular motion. This means that it has an acceleration that is pointing towards the center of the circle that this arc would have made. Now, Newton's second law therefore tells us that there has to be a force causing this acceleration, and the force must be pointing towards the center of the circle. Remember, if there is acceleration, there has to be a force producing the acceleration. In this case, the centripetal force is a frictional force on the tires from the road that makes a turn possible. In fact, I would like you to imagine that halfway across the arc, if this force was suddenly removed, where would the car have gone? Well, the car would have gone straight ahead simply because there was no force to pull it towards the center. Now, what about the passenger in the car? If you are to move in uniform circular motion along with the car, there has to be a centripetal force on you as well. Now, do not assume that the centripetal force on the car will automatically be transmitted to you as well. Remember free body diagrams. If you make a free body diagram of the car, the force is very much acting on the car. But if you were to draw the passenger's free body diagram, this force is not acting on the passenger. So, while the frictional force between the tires and the car was providing the required centripetal force to take the car in circular motion, this force was not available to you because you were sitting on the seat of the car. But then, lucky for you, there was a friction force between you and the seat of the car, which could have provided the centripetal acceleration. However, unfortunately, this frictional force on you from the seat was not large enough to hold you and make you go in a circle with the car. So try to visualize what is happening. The thing is that you actually continued moving straight ahead while the seat slid beneath you until the door of the car jammed into you. And then its push on you gave you the needed centripetal force and you started moving with the car in uniform circular motion. In fact, if the frictional force between you and the seat was high enough, let us say you were sitting on a Velcro seat and your pant kind of formed a Velcro lock with the seat, you would have not slid towards the door because you would have got adequate frictional force to provide you the required centripetal force, and you would have moved in a circular path with the car. In another example, let us say you are orbiting Earth in a space shuttle. So, what do you think is happening as the space shuttle and you orbit the Earth and you float inside the shuttle? In this case, both you and the shuttle are in uniform circular motion and the accelerations are directed towards the center of the circle. Again, by Newton's second law, a centripetal force must be present to cause these accelerations. And this time, the centripetal forces are due to the gravitational pull of the Earth, directed radially inwards towards the center of the Earth. Well, you might say that in both cases, that is a car and the shuttle, you are in uniform circular motion and are acted on by a centripetal force, but then your sensation in the two situations are quite different. In the car, jammed up against the door, you actually felt the compression on your body due to the door. But when you are in the shuttle, you are floating around with no sensation of any force acting on you. So why the difference? Well, the difference arises due to the nature of the two centripetal forces. When you are in the car, the centripetal force is the push on your body touching the car door. In the shuttle, the centripetal force is Earth's gravitational pull on every molecule or atom of your body, and you feel no compression on any one part of your body and no sensation of a force acting on you. So, using Newton's second law, we can write the magnitude of F of a centripetal force as F is equal to mv square upon r, and since the speed v here is constant, the magnitudes of the acceleration and the force also do not change and remain constant. However, you must note that the directions of the centripetal acceleration and force are continuously changing, so that they always point towards the center of the circle. And therefore, the force and acceleration vectors are usually drawn along the radial axis r that moves with the body, and the positive direction of the axis is radially outward, but the acceleration and force vectors point radially inwards. And finally, we will discuss the famous problem where a cyclist gathers so much speed that he is able to loop a vertical circle. So let us find what forces are acting on the cyclist and why he is able to loop the circle without falling at the top, despite the fact that all the forces seem to be acting on him vertically down. So the forces on the cyclist when he is at the top of the loop would be: one, the gravitational force acting in downward direction. Normal force from the loop is also in the downward direction. After all, the loop can only push down and not pull up. Thus, Newton's second law for this situation can be given as minus mg minus n is equal to m into minus a. And we've taken a as negative because it is directed downwards. And the same thing is true for mg and n. Both are directed downwards and therefore taken as negative. So let us rewrite this equation with a is equal to v square upon r. And what we get is minus mg minus n is equal to m into minus v square upon r. Now, the thing that will explain why the cyclist does not fall is understanding of the fact that when the cyclist is almost about to fall, he would have lost contact with the loop. That is, the cycle would have stopped touching the loop. So, as long as n is greater than or equal to 0, we can say that the loop is pushing against the cycle and the cycle is therefore not falling. So if you put n is equal to 0 in this equation, we get minus mg minus 0 is equal to m into minus v square upon r, or v is equal to root of gr. That is, as long as the velocity is greater than or equal to root of gr, the cyclist will not fall. So let us say the loop in which the cyclist is moving is 3 meters in radius. Then v is equal to root of 9.8 into 3, which equals 5.42 meters per second. That means if the cyclist is able to maintain a velocity greater than or equal to 5.42 meters per second at the top, he will not fall. And the moment the velocity becomes less than 5.42 meters per second, he will fall. And the most interesting thing about this derivation is that it is independent of mass. That is, the cyclist can be 50 kilograms in mass or 100 kilograms. He would need the same velocity to loop the loop successfully. So, if you don't want to spin in confusion, our playlist is your centripetal force through clarity. And like always, a thumbs up would be helpful. See you in the next video.